Hi Aparna.
Hey.
You're a viral content creator, a former Big Boss contestant, and now you're making your debut in a Malayalam film. And not just any Malayalam movie, but India's first artificial intelligence movie. So this journey seems to be quite interesting.
First of all, I wanted to say that this is my first interview in English. Oh. So I'm very interested to see how I'm able to express myself differently than in Malayalam. And also, this is gonna be the first interview that my parents, so special hi to my mom and dad, who's gonna finally understand what I'm talking about, because this interview is in English. Usually I am interviewed in Malayalam. So coming back to the question, yes, my first movie is coming out, Monica, Oru AI Story. So it's about a young child's story. He's heavily bullied at school. He's has this hyperactive tendency and not understood by his family, neglected. He's not getting enough affection and love from his family. And so he turns to external, you know, stimuli for some type of, acknowledgement. So that's how he finds AI. And I am the AI character in the movie, Monica. And I was able to give him support and actually really build his confidence and give him a grand career. So in this specific movie, I'm kind of like a mother figure for him. And it's interesting because when the director first approached me, he told me the story, and immediately I felt like I could relate to this character, Monica, because I am a teacher. I'm an English teacher here in Kerala, and I felt like the way that Monica was interacting with the boy in the movie, the actor's name is Shripad, the way that they were communicating was very much like my own personality. So I felt like Aparna Mulberry and Monica had a lot in common. So immediately I was like, okay, this feels like the perfect first role for me to go into as a debut film. So that's how it all started. I had been given some opportunities in the past, you know, whether this role would fit for you, but it never quite worked out. I didn't quite relate to it. And plus, for your first movie, you want it to be, okay, this is it.
The film seems to be discussing a relevant topic, addiction, mobile addiction among children. So can you talk about this?
This movie, the character, the boy, he has, his parents have neglected him completely. Mm-hmm. All of their attention is on his younger sister, and he's mm-hmm. also heavily bullied at school. So he doesn't have a choice but to turn to technology. So this movie, it's a movie definitely for parents and, you know, full families, like from the grandchildren, parents and grandparents, to come together and watch, because it's like a big eye awakening, like reminder for us to remember what's important in life. And the other side of the movie is the future of AI, which we can't really say the future because it's actually relevant now. Oh, it's already our reality. Even myself, I use ChatGPT and other AI tools for my content daily, you know, whether it's like removing a logo or to change the sound of something. This is all AI, filters, everything. So to see kind of through my character, through Monica in the movie, we're getting an idea, a small window into what's possible in the future. What can AI achieve? How can humans also grow and expand their intelligence through AI? So both of those aspects, like what's important in life, not to forget about those the connection, the bond between humans, and also the technology side of it.
Even in life, you seem to be having an easy way around children. Is it?
I love kids. I myself one day will have a bunch of kids. I want to adopt. I've always had that dream too, because there's so many kids without parents, and I felt, you know, I tried to give a better life to some child who may have been abandoned or something. But I love kids and I'm a teacher, so it comes naturally to me.
Since you spoke about becoming a mother, could you talk about your concept about families here in India and in the US?
Sure. So in the US, it's a very individualistic society. Usually, as an 18-year-old, you want to try to get out of your parents' house as soon as possible. Even myself, I turned 18 and I started doing these volunteer activities and I left my home. So like, if then you have children and then you have your family, but the parents live in a different house than the children as they're having family. So in order that you have to make appointments to meet, like for the grandchildren to meet the grandparents, it's like, let's set a date to like have some activity. So it's very individualistic. It's not a community-based upbringing. But here in Kerala, it's first of all, after a marriage, you're moving into your in-laws. That's usually the case. Now things are changing, but you're moving into your in-laws and you have your grandparents to look after the kids. Even like, for example, I have a few friends that got married and then moved to America after that. So Malayalis, both husband and wife, and they've moved to America and they're bringing up their children in America. But after the birth of their children, the grandparents fly from India to spend maybe 3-4 months to help. That stuff doesn't happen in the West. It's very rare. Maybe there'll be like exceptions, of course, but it's much more rare to have like kind of a community upbringing. And so I really see the value of having multiple hands to help and multiple people to help educate the children also, you know. Like I was raised, I find my upbringing to be the most blessed type of upbringing because I grew up in Amritapuri ashram, Mata Amritanamay Devi's ashram. So there's like thousands of people there at all given times. And all of these people were like my aunties, uncles, grandparents, great-grandparents, like they're all there and the kids are growing up and we're getting supported by all these people. So even like my parents had more of like a relaxed time because so many people were contributing to our upbringing.
Taking care of you.
So I saw, like when I talk about my childhood, I speak about it with such pride because really it was an amazing experience and I can only wish such a experience to others. So I also plan, if I have children, to have like a community setting, like whether it's, you know, an environment, self-sustainable community or like a farm where there's like multiple people and we have like chickens and, you know, like for eggs and that type of stuff, like a community setting. That's really what I look forward to in raising a child.
So do you see that future here in India or in the US?
That's a good question. I mean, at that point, the weather here is tough and in general I'm not a city person, so now that I live in Cochin, it's not that enjoyable for me. I often stay indoors like in my house, but if there's nature around, I'm just outside much more. And the nature that I know, with clean water that you can swim in, most of that is in the West. Like I wish that one day we can clean up our streets and India, clean up the rivers so that we have clean water and clean streets. I wish, and clean nature. It would be great for us to do that as like a community to clean India. But I find that day to be quite in the distant future. So we'll see.
Your videos help Malayalis better their English. How did this journey begin?
Yeah, so I've been teaching now for almost 12 years. I started teaching as a volunteer, and then after getting experience, I came back to my own childhood school here in Kollam, and I was teaching there as well. And I was very drawn to this career and of seeing the growth in my students. That was really what made it for me. So then for many years I was teaching English to Chinese children in China. I wasn't there, but we did it online. For maybe 5 years I was doing that. So I really understood the technique of teaching English as a second language. You know, you're learning another language other than your mother language. So then I got this opportunity over COVID to teach here in Kerala, and I was like, of course, like I learned Malayalam in Kerala. I would love to give back to the community and help with the English education. So now it's been over 3 years that I've been here and things have been going really well. I'm seeing so many positive results from my students.
An American or a Malayali, how do you identify yourself?
I feel like using the term global citizen is very relevant in my case. Because like you said, I was born in the United States, but my mother is also from Chile, South America. Okay. So we have like some Latina side also.
Oh, okay.
And then I came here when I was 3. So then the majority of my childhood, 15, I was in Kerala. So also I'm kind of a little bit Malu on the inside.
Only and a little then, or?
Nallu olu. Like a good chunk. And then I moved to Europe, so that was another big move. Actually, no, after here I moved to the US, and then I spent another like 12 years there, and then from there I moved to Europe, so it's like all these continents, and then even in Europe it was like Spain first, and then France, and then now I'm kind of back here again. So yeah, I just, this thing about how do you identify yourself, this has been a common thing throughout my life where I never quite felt like I belonged anywhere, and for a long time it gave me a lot of like identity crisis. Like I was like, how do I self-identify? When I'm in Kerala, I feel more American. When I'm in America, I feel more Indian. Like, where am I from? And I just couldn't pinpoint. And for some reason, I was stuck on this thing where I have to like identify as something. But actually recently I've, you know, after reflection, like, why do I feel like this? I realized that it's actually a superpower, because instead of saying like I don't fit in anywhere, it's I've changed the theme to I can fit in anywhere. Yeah, okay. Everywhere, anywhere. It doesn't matter. Like wherever I go, I feel like I can adjust to the culture because I've been adjusting to various cultures throughout the world. And it also comes from my parents. Both of them have like moved a lot, traveled a lot. And they were actually, they met in India, got married in India. So even from before I was born, I've had this kind of Indian roots with me. And so, yeah, it was a nice realization to kind of feel like, you know, actually I could belong anywhere as long as I just, you know, try to adjust and be a little bit more flexible. It's good to be flexible instead of stern. Like when you have your mind fixed on something, if something outside of that happens, you get disappointed. Mm-hmm. Expectations leads to disappointment. Anytime you expect something, very often you will be disappointed. So being able to be flexible is like that thing what I mentioned earlier, is to kind of flow with how life comes. And flexibility is a big part of being able to flow.
You were in Europe also for a while. Was that part of your job or because of your partner?
I moved there because of Amrita Shree, my partner. She is from Spain. She's Spanish, but now she works in France as a cardiologist.
Oh, okay.
So my whole European venture has been for her.
Okay. So you've been here in Kerala for 3 years, for the past 3 years, right?
Since Big Boss. That was like my first big move back, Big Boss.
Great move.
Yeah, that was like... hey, do you want to come on this TV show? And then I'm like, I don't live in India. No problem. Just like come a few months and then you can go back. Then I did the show and then I never really left. I mean, I've of course visited many times, but then also because my teaching career kept expanding. And so now it just makes more sense right now in this part of my life to be here. And it's nice to be there for my students and I can do like teacher meetups and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And my team also, we can do activities together. I love remote work, but there's some things which you don't get in remote work. You don't get that community team building thing. So being here helps for that.
A lot of Malayali youths these days are migrating outside for better opportunities. So as a US native, how do you see this trend here in Kerala?
Well, you never quite realize what you've lost until you lose it. You know, so a lot of youth or whoever, families that move abroad immediately will start missing Kerala, even though they just want to get out as soon as possible. When you get there, you miss everything about it. So it's really like that. So learning to appreciate what you have. But I totally understand, like there's a lot of opportunities in the West and people want to change things in their life. And a lot of my audience, a lot of my students are people who want to move abroad. So they're learning English with me. So I totally understand the need, and especially now in this day and age, to kind of maybe get better opportunities for your children and stuff like that. So I understand why people do it, but my only advice to people who do it is to try not to push away your roots as you're making these transitions. Like for me, when I was 15 years old, when I moved from India, from Kerala to the United States, and when I went to school, I was heavily bullied. People didn't understand me. They didn't understand where I came from. I was the weird white girl from India. Like they didn't really understand why I was there and what I was doing there. And so what I tried to do was I pushed away as much as possible my Indian roots in order to fit in to that culture. And then
you feel forced to do that.
Yeah, absolutely. I wanted to fit in. I didn't want to like be myself anymore because I was weird, or like I was this and that. And I was starting to believe the criticism that I was getting. But it was only after what happened was, I'll just give you that summary, is since I was pushing like my identity out of my existence so much, it brought me to a state of like intense confusion. Like, where do I belong? Who am I? This whole identity crisis thing started around there. And it wasn't the best years of my life. Like, my mental health, I think, was like the worst ever. But what happened was, I was able, from that experience, as soon as I started embracing where I came from, embracing who I am, everything changed. Like, my outlook from negative immediately went to positive. I was like, oh wow, actually, like, I have Indian roots, let me try to share that with the people in the United States. And then things started changing. So my point is, appreciate and honor where you come from and your language. Like, if children who are raised in America with Malayali parents, it makes me so sad when the children don't speak Malayalam. You know, of course they're going to learn English. They're going to be fluent in English. They're going to learn English at school with their friends. But at least at home, the parents, I feel, should put more of an effort to teach their children. Their children might not want it. Even though they don't want it, just teach them language. Because later, my inbox is full of like young adults saying, I wish my family would have taught me Malayalam. You speak better Malayalam than me. Can you teach me Malayalam? I wish I learned Malayalam when I was a kid. So thousands of people are writing to me daily that they wish their parents would have continued speaking to them in Malayalam. So my only advice is, people who want to go, enjoy, you know, like, get amazing careers, get amazing opportunities, but remember where you're from and your roots, and also at some point try to contribute back to your society. Kerala needs you as much as you need these opportunities, so try to come home and contribute also to society here.
So are they trying to come back to their roots by learning Malayalam now?
It feels that way. I feel like at some point, this other side of things where they get a lot of shame from their family, even from their parents, Malayalam arniyuda. You should have learned it. It was their duty to teach, but now they're criticizing because they don't know. So then a lot of guilt comes from that. I am from this culture, yet I don't speak the language. And that creates like conflict internally. And in order to satisfy that conflict, a lot of people turn to, okay, so what can I do? Okay, I can try to learn Malayalam. But at that point, Malayalam padikan bhayangara paada. It's so difficult to learn Malayalam. I know so many people who've been trying for like 5 years, like my partner included. It's her fifth year. എന്നിട്ട് എന്തെങ്കിലും പറഞ്ഞു കഴിഞ്ഞാൽ എന്തൊക്കെയോ പറഞ്ഞിട്ട് അങ്ങ് ലൈക്ക് വാക്കുകൾ അറിയാം, പക്ഷെ അത് സെന്റൻസ് ആക്കാനും ആ ഒരു ഫ്ലുവൻസി എനിക്ക് തോന്നില്ല. ലൈക്ക് ഇൻ കുറെ പ്രാക്ടീസ് ചെയ്യണം. യു ഹാവ് ടു ബി സോ ഡെഡിക്കേറ്റഡ് ഇൻ ഓർഡർ ടു റിയലി ബ്രിങ് ദാറ്റ് ഫ്ലുവൻസി ടു ലൈഫ്.
സോ ഡിഡ് യു സീ യുവർ സെൽഫ് ആക്ടിംഗ് ഇൻ മൂവീസ്?
I didn't even see myself like creating content as like a career or anything. I just started creating content, or I wasn't even creating content. I just started a page, this inverted coconut page I started in COVID because I couldn't come back to India. Indian government canceled all foreign visas. So all foreigners who used to live here got kicked out or got stuck abroad. So I'm stuck. I'm not able to come home. My mom is here. I didn't see my mom for a bunch of years because I couldn't come. And Malayalam, as it being a super incredibly difficult language, if you're not practicing, you will lose it. At least for me, as it's not my mother tongue, it's my learned language. If I'm not practicing it, my fluency decreases super fast. So because of that, my fear of forgetting this language, I started this page only to speak in English, Malayalam. I would post, I wasn't even posting on my feed, I was only posting on my stories because I promised myself at least 1 minute per day I would speak in Malayalam. In order to hold myself accountable, I was making 1 minute stories every single day about random topics just so I spoke. And then somehow my page started getting shared, and then like And then I realized, oh, people like to see me trying to speak Malayalam. So then I started making content, and then, you know, one thing after another, my videos were going viral.
Could you share a few words in Malayalam to the audience? It could be about the film, it could be about yourself.
തീർച്ചയായിട്ടും. സോ ഇനി വരാൻ പോകുന്ന എൻ്റെ ആദ്യത്തെ പടം മോണിക്ക ഒരു AI സ്റ്റോറി, ഒരു നമ്മൾ നേരത്തെ പറഞ്ഞ പോലെ തന്നെ ഇറ്റ് ഹാസ് ലൈക്ക് ഒരു കോമ്പിനേഷൻ ബിറ്റ്വീൻ നമ്മൾ മറന്നു പോയി കാര്യങ്ങൾ, അതായത് നമ്മളുടെ ഹ്യൂമൻ ബോണ്ടിൻ്റെ ഇമ്പോർട്ടൻസും, പിന്നെ നമ്മൾ ഒരു ബാലൻസ് ബിറ്റ്വീൻ അതും പിന്നെ ടെക്നോളജിയുടെ AI ടെക്നോളജിയുടെ ഒരു ബന്ധമാണ്. അപ്പോൾ തീർച്ചയായിട്ടും ഫുൾ ഫാമിലി വന്നിട്ട് കാണാൻ ഒരു പടമാണ്, എന്തായാലും തീർച്ചയായിട്ടും എല്ലാവരും വന്നിട്ട് കാണണം. ആൻഡ് പിന്നെ ഞാൻ അതിലൊരു പാട്ട് പാടി, ഒരു ഡാൻസും കളിച്ചു, എങ്ങനെയൊക്കെയോ ഞാൻ ഡാൻസ് കളിച്ചു. എനിക്കറിഞ്ഞിട്ട് ഐം ടാക്കിംഗ് അബൌട്ട് ലൈക്ക് ഐ ഹാഡ് ടു സിംഗ് എ സോങ് ആൻഡ് ഡാൻസ് ഫോർ ദ ആസ് ദ പ്രൊമോ സോങ്. ഐ ആം നോട്ട് എ ഡാൻസർ, ഐ എം ക്വൈറ്റ് സ്റ്റിഫ് ആൻഡ് റോബോട്ടിക് ആൻഡ് വെരി ഓക്വേർഡ്. And they called me to like learn this dance, and there was a bunch of dancers, experts, like that's their career, they dance for a living. And the choreographer would show them the move one time, many moves together, adu kaanichittu ellarum endu bangayitta immediately aa saana kaanu. And then I'm like, I didn't even understand the first thing. Yep, uh-huh. So this poor choreographer had to break everything down like a million times for me. And I'm struggling so hard. That was like this whole thing. And somehow I was able to do it with a lot of help from everybody. So yesterday, last night, was the release of the promo song. So I think by the time you all see this video, it's probably going to be on YouTube. So you can search promo song.
That is sung by you.
Also sung by me, yes, yeah.
Okay. I heard you sing well. Could you sing for the audience?
Okay. I'm going to look up some lyrics because I always butcher Malayalam when I'm like trying to sing. So I'm going to get some lyrics here for you guys. Pariyade, ariyade, ni poya thalli മരുവാക്ക് മിന്താനിയതല്ലേ, ഒരു നോക്കു കാണാതെ നീ പോയതല്ലേ, ദൂരേക്കു നീ മാന്യതല്ലേ, സഖിയെ നീ കാണുന്നുവോ എൻ മെഴുകൾ നിറയുന്നൊൻപരും, എന്നും ഓർക്കുന്നുവോ വീണ്ടും ഓർക്കുന്നുവോ അന്ന് നാം കണ്ടലിൽ പിരിയുരാവ്, ഇന്നും ഓർക്കുന്നു ഞാൻ, ഇന്നും ഓർക്കുന്നു ഞാൻ അന്ന് ഞാൻ കണ്ടു പിരിയുരാവ്.
ലവ്ലി സോങ്. Okay, thank you Aparna for being with us today.
I really appreciate this interview because the whole time I was thinking about my family. They've never been able to understand what I'm saying as I'm giving these talks. So the whole time I was thinking about them, like when I was talking, like I was talking to my dad and stuff. So that was like a really sweet experience for me. And also I was talking to everybody, Malayali families who have moved abroad or might have some connection with, you know, Kerala. And yeah, I hope that people can somewhat feel inspired, maybe come back one day. I'm planning a bunch of stuff, like including animal, if anybody's interested in animal welfare. I'm like, that's my destiny in life. Like, that's why I'm working now, is so that I can save some money to like start some big animal welfare project here. So if anybody who's abroad who wants to be a part of this, please do message me. Probably 2025-ish, let's see, hopefully with grace. The stepping stones will come into place. And also for anybody who is looking to move abroad or to learn English, my new academy, my own baby is launching. My academy, language academy, is launching this coming August. Okay. So it's called Speaky AI. We're using a lot of AI features so that students can get more practice speaking, because right now that's the thing that I saw in Kerala that was the most lacking, which was people have karuv, they have the ability and the talent to speak. They know what to say, but they're just not building that confidence. And it's through extra practice and speaking that we can really reach that level of confidence and fluency. So we'll have like 24/7 access to AI coaches, and also me being a native speaker, y'all can come and learn with me. So really looking forward to that. Thank you for having me on the show and for this experience.
Thank you.
Okay.